I would like to invite, without any further ado, Advocate Anil Harish, a renowned advocate having fought numerous cases. Mr. Harish is the partner of DM Harish & Company. Mr. Harish specializes in the field of corporate law, joint ventures, collaborations, property, mergers and acquisitions, demergers, LLPs, taxation, arbitration, exchange control, foreign investments, trust, wills, and Indian as well as international taxation. A huge round of applause. Let's give it up for Advocate Anil Harish. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Sanjay Chaturvedi, Mr. Ajay Chaturvedi, Dr. Niranjan Hiranandani, Mr. Yadav, Mr. Vagha, and ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, my congratulations to Accommodation Times for having given us so much information, so much thought and analysis and research, and conducting so many training programs throughout these years. This has really been a great service to the real estate sector. We wish Murariji also the very best and hope that he will have a quick and very efficient recovery. Ladies and gentlemen, my subject today is FEMA. Exchange control and restrictions were introduced in India on 2nd September 1939, on the outbreak of the Second World War. Today we are in 2019. That means we have had exchange control restrictions for 80 years. Article 14 of the International Monetary Fund Agreement says that exchange controls are more suitable for transitional economies. But India has gone beyond that. We are now a much more mature economy than ever before. We have large exchange reserves. And this is a time when we should start thinking about phasing out these because they do impose impediments in our transactions. When exchange control was introduced in 1939, it was under the Defense of India Regulations. Then came the FERA, the Foreign Exchange Regulation Act 1947, which was then substituted by the Foreign Exchange Regulation Act 1973, and now it's the Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999, which holds the field. So what does the subject do? What does it seek to regulate? It's not a taxing statute like the Income Tax Act is. It is a regulatory statute. So it must regulate something. We are residents of India. If we hold property in India or buy or sell, we do not need Reserve Bank approval. If a person is a non-resident and makes his own investment in his own country, whether it be America or England or wherever, he doesn't obviously need Reserve Bank approval. FERA and now FEMA regulate transnational holdings and activities. That means if a resident of India has some transaction outside India or a person who is non-resident has a transaction in India, this is the subject matter of regulation. Now, this regulation has taken many forms. It is, one aspect is that there are limitations on the amount that you can take out of the country. You know that in the 1960s, the position was so critical that if a person went abroad for a holiday, for example, then all the foreign exchange that he was allowed was $8. That was really an invitation to people to do hawala transactions and get money outside India. So the laws permitted that, encouraged that, provided for that. Even in England, there were foreign exchange restrictions. And in 1966, if a person from England went out on a holiday, all that he was allowed to take out was £50. And another £15 in cash, so only £65. So in England also there were many violations of foreign exchange, as there were in India. But of course the position has changed substantially, and you can now take on much more money, as I'm sure many of you know, which I will address presently. So today I will talk about four particular aspects in relation to real estate, and then one other general one. If a non-resident wants to invest in India, that's one subject we will cover. If a resident of India wants to invest in a property outside India, that's the second. The third is, if a company or anyone from outside wants to do business in India, not really take make an investment in India, but do a real estate business in India. That's a third. And the fourth is, if an Indian entity wants to do business in real estate outside India, these are the four major subjects that we will cover. Now, NRIs, that means non-resident Indian citizens, are allowed to invest into India. They can either get the money from overseas and buy property in India, or they can use local money, NRO funds, if they have them here. They can use that money to buy property. When they earn income, then they are allowed, after payment of tax, to debit out the funds, because there are some remittance facilities that are available now. And one unusual thing which many people do not know or forget about is this, that while there is a liberalized remittance facility of being able to remit out $250,000 US in every financial year, if a non-resident makes an investment in foreign exchange and keeps records of the fact that he brought in foreign exchange and gets the inward remittance certificates, etc., then the Reserve Bank of India regulation says that when he sells a property, he can take out the entire amount that he brought in dollar terms and not restricted to $250,000 US. So that's an important facility that is available. Now, while a non-resident Indian citizen can invest, what about a person who has become a foreign citizen after having left from here? Suppose a person has gone from here, he was a non-resident Indian, then he got, for example, US citizenship. Now, he's no longer an Indian. He is what used to be called a person of Indian origin. But there has been a change to that also. And the Citizenship Act 1955 was amended on 10th March 2015 to expand the scope of persons who are classified as OCI, Overseas Citizens of India Cardholders. The law uses the term OCI Cardholders. So it's not only persons who are Indian citizens and have now become foreign citizens, but those whose parents or whose grandparents were Indian citizens, and also now the spouse of a foreign citizen, who is the foreign spouse of a person who is an OCI cardholder, will also classify to be an OCI cardholder and can make an investment into India. There are still some restrictions. A person who does not have any Indian connection, who is not of Indian origin, or who is not married to a person of Indian origin, cannot invest in India. So, for instance, although Mr. Donald Trump does participate in businesses in India and in real estate ventures, if he himself wanted to buy a flat in India, he's not allowed to do so. So this is one area where I think changes are needed, and I will come to that presently. So non-resident Indians are permitted to invest in India as our OCI cardholders, but not foreigners, unless they come to India, they reside in India for more than 182 days in a financial year, and have a long-term visa, and have a purpose of staying here. So not if they just come on a tourist visa, but if they actually have a work permit, or a professional visa, or a business visa, and spend a substantial amount of time, then they can buy property. Now we know that so many foreigners come to India, some of them buy property in Goa and other places. All of them are not legally doing so, but in some situations they may be legally doing so, and others they are not doing so. So one has to go to that, and these are the regulations that we have. Now, insofar as persons who are in India who want to invest outside India, yes, you know that we can do that now. In the old days, there were very tight foreign exchange restrictions. But today, under the NRIs, the liberalized remittance scheme, each resident of India, including a minor, can remit out up to 250,000 US. So we find that many people are investing in flats in London and Dubai and Singapore and other places. The NRS directions say very clearly that general approval is given to a person who is resident of India to remit out 250,000 US, to open a bank account without having to take prior approval for that account, provided he sends the money from here officially. He can buy property with it, he can invest in shares also of companies, he can do debt instruments, he can lend money to people, so that facility is available. But But while under the exchange control regulations, you can debit out money, you must remember that there is another very important law in India which regulates all kinds of holdings and activities, and that is the Income Tax Act. So don't just be blinded by the fact that yes, you are allowed to do this. You must remember that there are many procedures that have to be followed, there are many declarations that have to be made, not merely to the Reserve Bank, but to the Income Tax Department. So even if you debit money out, open a bank account, buy a property, give it out on rent, for example, you must make a declaration in your income tax return if you are a resident in India. The income tax return forms nowadays, from assessment year 2012-13 onwards, have Schedule FA and Schedule FSI. Schedule FA stands for foreign assets, and Schedule FSI stands for foreign source income. So if you have any account outside India or any property or you've given a loan to anyone, you have to include all those particulars in Schedule FA. If you do not, firstly, there can be a penalty of 10 lakhs of rupees, even though you do not earn any income. So you may have opened a current account, you do not earn 1 rupee or $1 in that, but just the fact that you have it, if you do not declare, means that there can be a penalty of 10 lakhs. But more serious than that is the Black Money Act. Now, there is another law since 2015 called the Black Money Act, whereby if the Income Tax Department finds that you have an asset outside India which you have not declared, then they can penalize you. They first tax you, which will be say, the rate of 30-35%. The penalty can be 3 times the amount of the tax, so it can be, say, 105%, so the total becomes 140, and then there can be a prosecution as well. In fact, in the last 2 weeks, we find, or the last month or so, the Income Tax Department has become very active. And every day, clients are getting notices under the Black Money Act and under the Income Tax Act, so they have to comply with all these regulations and months. And even if a person has an account since the old days, which has not been declared, which may have been fueled by unofficial money, or just forgot to declare it, or if a person has an asset outside India, before you get a notice, please declare it. Whatever is the amount of tax you have to pay, just pay it. You have to pay tax, you have to pay interest, pay it. Try and avoid the penalty, and try and avoid the prosecution. Now, the third will be foreign companies or foreign individuals wanting to invest in India into the real estate sector. These regulations were first changed in the year 2005. At that time, press note number 2 of 2005 was issued, which laid down many conditions. One of them was that the minimum size of the project should be 50,000 square meters and so on. Now those restrictions are no longer there, and therefore a foreign company or a foreign individual can invest into a company in India which is doing real estate and does not have to have a project of more than 50,000 square meters. It can even be a smaller project. The regulations use some strange terms. They say that a person investing from overseas is not allowed to do real estate business. Now that could appear to be a shock. Why should they not be allowed to do real estate business? But they define real estate business as meaning buying and selling a property and trading in TDRs. So only buying and selling a property and trading in TDRs are treated as real estate business and are not permitted. But the regulations go on to say that development of townships, construction of residential and commercial complexes, constructing hospitals and hotels and educational institutions, and construction of roads and bridges are permitted, and these do not constitute real estate business. So, Niranjan, on the basis of what the Reserve Bank says, you are not doing real estate business. But the recent regulation goes on to say that leasing is permitted. That was not clear in the past. Now it appears that a person investing from overseas into a company in India which buys property, not just with a view to sell it soon, but to hold it and lease it, would be a proper activity which is permitted in this FDI regime, foreign direct investment. But here also we have to remember that there are many procedures. When you invest into a company, when a person from overseas invests into a company in India, the Indian company must get an inward remittance certificate and submit that to the Reserve Bank of India within 30 days of the money coming in. Then it has to issue shares within 6 months of the money having come in. And then it has to submit form FCGPR to the Reserve Bank of India. If a company misses out on this, if they don't follow these procedures, then the matter goes not to the RBI, but goes to the Enforcement Directorate, which is to the enforcement arm of the Foreign Exchange Management Act. And they carry out proceedings. They have the power to levy a penalty of up to 3 times the amount involved. They also have the power to prosecute. For a long time after FEMA came in, they did not have the power of prosecution, but again, now they do have that power, as they used to have under FEMA. So there was a matter recently where a person had gotten money into a company from a foreigner and had not made the declaration. So the matter went on before the enforcement director, there were many hearings and so on, and finally a penalty was levied both on the Indian company and the director of the Indian company because there was his responsibility to declare and he had not done so. Then we had to file an appeal to the enforcement tribunal in Delhi. So this goes on. In fact, these kind of regulations remind me of a cartoon that I once saw of a batsman who hit the ball, but instead of taking a run, he sat down on the bench, pulled out a pad and pen from his pocket, and he had to write something. So the North striker came to him and said, "What are you doing? Let's take a run." He said, "No, first I have to fill out a form in triplicate." The regulations are much easier now than they used to be, but you still do have to be very conscious about the income tax procedures and about the Reserve Bank of India procedures. The fourth is investment from India into a business overseas. When money comes into India, it's called foreign direct investment. When it goes out from India, it's classified as overseas direct investment, ODI. Now, under the ODI regulations, they have certain aspects which can be done without going to the Reserve Bank of India for specific approval. In other words, the automatic route, and then there is the approval route. So, a partnership firm, an LLP, and a company are permitted to remit out under the ODI scheme up to 4 times the net worth of the company. So, if for example, a company has capital of, say, 1 crore, and it has reserves which have accumulated over the years of 4 crores of rupees, that means its net worth is 5 crores. This company, if it wants to do real estate activity outside India, can debit out not just 5 crores, it can even borrow 15 crores and then send out 20 crores because its net worth is 5, so it can debit out 20 crores of rupees and can participate in the activity of a company outside India. Again, it's not allowed to do real estate business because real estate business means buying and selling of properties or buying and selling of TDR, whether that country overseas has TDR or not. But they do say that development of townships and construction of residential and commercial complexes will be permitted. Now, the ODI Master Circular is not in exactly the same terms as the FDI Master Circular. The FDI says that even leasing is permitted as part of the is part of the permitted activity. The ODI circular does not say that, but I feel that it should be allowed, and maybe one would have to make a representation to the Reserve Bank to be able to invest from an entity here into an entity outside of India, buy property and lease it out or carry on construction and so on, but not really just buying and selling. The procedures are quite simple. You just have to go to your bank and fill in form ODI and then get a certificate from a chartered accountant in form 15CA and 15CB, and you can debit out the money in a week or 10 days. So it's very easy. And then every year you have to submit an APR, an annual performance report. So things have changed a great deal over these 19 years of FEMA compared to what they were in the FEMA days. But there is still a lot of room for change. At this point of time, when the real estate sector has a great paucity of money, then I think that there could be some changes in the exchange control regulations which could make it easier for real estate. One is at the individual level. That today, as I mentioned, foreigners are not allowed to buy in India. You know that from India, people rent out large sums of money to buy flats in London and Dubai and other places. Why should foreigners not be able to buy in India? Maybe they can have some restrictions. They can say that only one property in India can be bought by one individual foreigner. They may not allow to speculate. They may have a minimum holding period, a lock-in period, as they have for investment into businesses. They can say that if you invest here, you must hold it for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years, and only then can you sell it out. But see what advantages there will be. The whole world will become your market. You will be able to get so many persons to invest in flats in India, and offices and so on at a personal level. And when they invest here, there will be other things. They will do catalog furnishing, they will come visit India, so tourism, both official and holiday tourism will increase. So the benefits for India can be all down the line, and particularly in the real estate sector. The second thing that I feel that needs to be done from a FEMA point of view is that up to now, an overseas entity has been allowed to invest into an Indian entity, but only if it is in equity shares or in compulsorily convertible preference shares or compulsorily convertible debentures. In other words, it has necessarily to become equity. Now, what Indian companies need is money. They don't necessarily want it in the form of equity. And foreigners also don't necessarily want to put it into equity because there is a risk. Many people from overseas would like to give loans in India. Many people in India would like to take loans, but they're just not allowed to take it into the real estate sector. ECBs, external commercial borrowings, are permitted in other sectors, in infrastructure, in hotels, but not in the real estate sector. There's no reason for this at all, and I think that this is really outlived. These regulations have outlived their usefulness. Some years ago, they announced ECBs for affordable housing, but there were so many conditions in that, I think that no affordable housing company must have taken a loan under the ECB sector. I think if this were changed, then a real estate company in India would be able to borrow at 3 or 4%, and even if they take the exchange risk on them, because the Indian rupee has been losing on an average about 6% or 7% a year. So, even if it becomes a total cost of 3 to 4% as interest, and say 6% on foreign exchange, the total cost is 10% or something, which is in many cases necessary and very easily affordable for an Indian entity. So I think these are some of the changes that can be made. Dr. Sanjay Chaturvedi talked about research and the importance of research. I feel that this is a subject on which research could be done. I feel also that research must be done, and I've said this before, on the amount of foreign exchange that the real estate sector earns for India. We know that diamond exporters have earned so much, textile exporters and garment exporters have earned, but we just have no clue about how much the real estate sector has gotten, directly and indirectly. So research needs to be done on this, and the fruit of this research should be given to the government in terms of the foreign exchange and these suggestions to bring it for the foreign exchange. And I think that this can make a big difference to the real estate sector in India. So I wish all of you happy investing, and once again, my congratulations to the Accommodation Banks.